Let's go on to the Word of God, to our text this morning, to Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, and verses 51 and 52. Luke 2, 51 and 52. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them, but his mother treasured all these things in her heart. But Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. A very well-known passage of scripture, especially verse 52. A scripture verse that is taught and learned by children right from Sunday school. If you've been through Sunday school in VBS, I'm sure you just know it by heart. Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and favor with God and favor with men. Jesus grew in wisdom. Wow. Jesus needed growth. Really? And Jesus needed growth in wisdom? Of course, in stature physically, he was growing up. Come with me to Colossians. And chapter number 1. And verses 15 to 18. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. Verse 17, he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. In everything he has the supremacy. He's the God of all creation. He's the God who created thrones and powers and authorities. And all things were created by him and for him. In him all things are held together. He's the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. He's the only supreme God, supreme being who has everything, who possesses all things. But in the text that we read this morning in Luke 2:52, the scripture talks about Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. Increased in favor with God, increased in favor with men, increased in wisdom, grew. He needed growth. Yes, because he was truly human as well. Truly human, truly divine. And it's in his humanness, his growing up as just like any other baby, as any other child, growing up as any other boy, had to battle with temptations, had to deal with the issues of his life, but of course never failed, never sinned, but yet grew in wisdom. And here you come to understanding and knowing that Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and favor with God and man, which simply tells us that if he needed to grow, how much more do we, as human beings, as people, as a creation of God, as created beings, need wisdom, need the grace of God, need favor with man, and how much we need to grow in these areas of life. We need to grow. And nobody can say that I have fully grown. Maybe our physical stature, the growth in our physical stature, has come to a certain level where we say we've grown. He's a grown-up person. But we do keep growing. I've been having some new skin. Nails are growing. There's growth happening all the time. And here Jesus is growing in wisdom. Wisdom. It begins with wisdom. Wisdom and favor with God and favor with man. We need the wisdom of God. And that's why the wise man Solomon said, do not be wise in your own eyes. Do not be wise in your own eyes with all the wisdom that he had been endowed with. With all the wise decisions that he had taken. With all the wisdom he has displayed in his kingship and exerting judgments. He says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. We all know very well Proverbs 9:10 that says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Which tells us that there is space and room for growth and progress and development in wisdom. We need wisdom. We need to be wise. Be wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove, Jesus said. We need the wisdom of God. There are people who live by the wisdom of the world. And that's what you see all through the book of Proverbs, where there's a huge contrast which Solomon the wise man brings out about the wisdom of the world and the wisdom of God. The wisdom of the world is in stark contrast to the wisdom of God. The principles of the word of God will always be very, very different, in total contradiction to the pattern, to the system, to the principles of the world. And you see Jesus growing in wisdom and in stature, in favor with God, in favor with man. There was no doubt that he was constantly displaying wisdom everywhere he went. Because when people began to question him, when people tried to trap him, when they asked him very tricky questions, should we pay taxes? What about resurrection? Marriage after resurrection? They were asking him very tricky questions. But in every time that they asked, and when every time when Jesus responds, you will find that they were all amazed at the way he spoke. That they were, their questions were self-defeating, that they were confounded. That they found themselves to be like fools in the eyes of everybody, while they actually thought that they were asking a very sharp, shrewd, wise question. They thought that they can trap Jesus in his words. You see the wisdom of God displayed. Even right up there when he was 12 years old, when Jesus and his parents had come to the feast according to the custom. If you just look up the passage of Luke 2 in verse 42-43. And parents were returning home. The boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem and they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled for 3 days. And come down to verse 46. After 3 days, they found him in the temple court, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. In verse 47, everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. Everybody was amazed at his understanding and his answers. Even to ask the right kind of questions, you need wisdom. Leave alone answering questions. Even to ask the right question, there's a need for a lot of wisdom and understanding to even ask questions. But here Jesus was asking questions and answering, and everybody was amazed at his wisdom. You see, Jesus, his wisdom displayed from his childhood, from when he was 12 years old, all the way through his life and his public ministry, even at the time when he was cross-questioned by Pilate and Caesar. Even while he was taken for trial, he speaks with such wisdom. God is a God of wisdom. And he has made us to be people with wisdom. Hallelujah. Thank God for wisdom that comes from God. Thank God because God has given us the wisdom that we need. Just imagine if we were all just unwise. Which sometimes we are. Just imagine if we just had no wisdom at all. We would be doing all kinds of things. we would be putting ourselves in places and in situations that will turn totally against us, that will defeat us, that will destroy our lives. A lack of wisdom can simply bring destruction upon somebody's life. But with wisdom, you can gain life. Hallelujah. Wisdom is a very powerful thing. We hardly desire wisdom. We hardly seek for wisdom. We hardly embrace wisdom. We very rarely pay our attention or focus on being wise. And asking ourselves, am I wise in this? Is this the wisest thing to do? Very often, we are led by feelings and emotions and not by wisdom. A life that is led by emotions and feelings will lead us into destruction, because what we feel and how we think out of our feelings and our emotions can be so misleading, can be very self-destructive. And here Jesus is growing in wisdom. It's interesting to see that wisdom was existent even before creation of mankind. Even before the creation of the world, wisdom existed. Come with me to Proverbs in chapter number 8. In verses 22 to 29, we need to grow in wisdom. We need to increase in wisdom. Look at the existence of wisdom in Proverbs 8 and verse 22 to 29. The Lord brought me forth as the first of His works, before His deeds of old. I was appointed from eternity, from the beginning, before the world began. When there were no oceans, I was given birth. When there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains were settled in its place. Before the hills, I was given birth. Before He made the earth or its fields or any of the dust of the world, I was there when He set the heavens in place, when He marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, when He established the clouds above and fixed securely the mountains of the deep, when He gave the sea's boundary so the waters could not overstep its command, when He marked out the foundations of the earth. Then I was a craftsman at His side. Verse 30. I was filled with the delight day after day, rejoicing always in His presence, rejoicing in His whole world and delighting in mankind. Wisdom was existent before the creation of the world. Before the creation of mankind, wisdom existed. Because wisdom comes from God. God is the author of wisdom. He's the Bible says He's the invisible, the only wise God. Without Him, there is no wisdom. And many a times, because we did not act in wisdom, or because we did not speak wisely, because we did not act tactfully, we have suffered a lot. And how often don't we look back and think, how unwise was I? Where did my wisdom go? Why didn't it dawn to me? If only I had thought through. If only I had got somebody's wise counsel. Maybe sometimes we look at others and say, oh, you are a wise person. You don't get washing machines on loan. You're a very wise person. My fridge is on loan. My washing machine is on loan. My microwave is on loan. My 4-burner stove is on loan. And sometimes after everything has piled up, then we look back and think, oh, I wish I had had that old, you know, stove which my father-in-law bought when I got married. I wish I had retained with that little fridge that came as a dowry. Sometimes don't we think later on, after a few years have gone by, after a while, after a long time, and sometimes it's too late to think, Because we've done so many things and we've taken so many decisions and we've moved in several directions and we've spoken many things and we've taken a stand on certain things. Sometimes out of great passion we've taken stand. I will never enter this house even if I die. But then after a while, well, there's some problem, there's nobody else other than that house who come to help us. Then we regret, oh, how foolish I was to say I will never enter that house, because only now they are only there to help me. Sometimes our aggressiveness, sometimes our very strong stand and great passion and everything sometimes seem to be as if we are very wise and very smart in saying things the way we say it, taking the decisions that we are taking, and being very zealous for certain things. We say, oh, this is my principle. But ultimately, sometimes we come to a realization later on as we grow in wisdom, as we grow in understanding, as we grow in the knowledge of God, as we grow in the knowledge of the Word of God, we come later on to a point, and life teaches us some hard lessons as well, and we realize how foolish, how miserable I was. And so is wisdom necessary for us? Firstly, we need to come to a point where we acknowledge that I lack wisdom. That is when we will even sense a need for wisdom. Bible says that anybody who thinks he knows everything knows nothing. If we claim to know everything, we actually know nothing. And so we cannot say that I am wise, I know it all. I can take my decisions, I've done things right, I know what I'm doing. Nobody can exalt himself in such a manner, because the wisdom of God is greater than the wisdom of mankind. He is the author of wisdom. Wisdom was existent even before we were born. Even before mankind was created, wisdom was there. God, who is the author of wisdom, is the giver of wisdom as well. Hallelujah. He's the giver of wisdom. How many students know the verse about wisdom thoroughly? Because exam season is coming. Sometimes we think, well, we quote exam verses all through the night and have the Bible under our pillows. Sometimes wisdom can get transferred. We don't have some Bluetooth effect to have transfer of data into our minds. Well, we have to study. Of course, God gives wisdom. James chapter 1. Now, this is in the context of trials. This is not in the context of education. James chapter 1, and some people see education as a trial. That's a different matter. James chapter 1 in verse 2 to 5. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Perseverance, through persevering through trials, will have to finish its work. Then we will not lack anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He's a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. And so while we go through trials, and as we are persevering in this life, that produces maturity. And while we grow into maturity, we lack nothing. And we still find ourselves lacking. And we need the grace of God to go through trials and persevere and mature. We need to ask God for wisdom. As we go through trials, as we go through the process of maturing in Christ, and the circumstances of life teach us to persevere, to mature, and then we will be made complete,
And there, if we lack wisdom, we should ask God, and God is a giver of wisdom, and He will give wisdom.
There's no one who is without wisdom, because God created everyone in His image, and He is full of wisdom and truth. And so as we, as His creation, who've been created by God, have been blessed by wisdom, He's deposited His wisdom into us. But here, as Jesus was growing in wisdom, we also need to grow. And it's important that we recognize that I need wisdom. I lack wisdom. I need wisdom. And the moment you recognize your lack of wisdom and the need for wisdom, you will begin to desire and embrace wisdom. And that's what Solomon, the wise man, is teaching and saying, embrace wisdom. There's a difference between knowledge and wisdom. We need to understand that. Knowledge is really about facts and ideas, what we acquire through study, research, observation, investigation, experiences. All of these are knowledge. We acquire knowledge. It's acquired. But wisdom is the ability to discern and judge which aspects of the knowledge are true and right and what to be used when. That's wisdom, which is applicable to life. If Jesus increased in wisdom, we need to increase in wisdom. That settles it for us. If He Himself needed to grow in wisdom, I need to grow in wisdom. I need the wisdom of God. And I was really curious to find, how did He grow in wisdom? How did He grow in wisdom? When did He grow in wisdom? And it seemed to be like it was in the silence of the number of years about His life, which by the leading of the Holy Spirit, the writers of the Gospels have not included. The silence of His years between 12 and 8:30. We last see His record of His life in 12, and then we see it in 30, where He comes out in public ministry, and before that He goes on a fasting and prayer for 40 days and 40 nights. For these 18 years, the Bible is silent about His life. And I'm sure from His childhood, like every Jewish child who grows up in the learning of the first five books of the Bible, which is called as a Torah, definitely he would have learned the scriptures, born in a Jewish family. And I believe that he was growing even through the years of the silence, where the scriptures do not give us any clear detail other than that he was obedient to his parents and went to live with his parents. And probably, it is understood that maybe Joseph died somewhere along the way. And that's why from the cross, Jesus hands over his mother to his beloved disciple John. And as the firstborn of the family, where his responsibility was to take care of her, he hands her over to John the disciple. Probably this could be a possibility. But no record of what he was doing exactly during those 18 years. Definitely he was carrying on the father's profession of carpentry. And as a young person involved in the father's work, needed wisdom. Maybe there were some clients who didn't pay him. Maybe there were some customers who were displeased with his work and rejected it. Some of us don't like to think about Jesus in that way at all. He was a young boy growing up learning carpentry. Maybe he was very skilled and did everything very well. Maybe he sold all his goods very well. We do not know. But definitely during the silent years, I'm sure he was growing. He was growing. He was human. He was a young boy. He was a teenager. He was growing into his 20s. He's growing. No record, but yet he was definitely preparing himself for his public ministry, I assume.
Because his 3.5 years of doing the work of God was so powerful. Unlike any other prophet, unlike any other priest, unlike any other king. What he did in his public life was amazing. And also there seemed to be something very similar to that also happening to the Apostle Paul, because as he gets saved on the road to Damascus, and then if you find that for 3 years he was away in Arabia and Damascus, if you look at Galatians chapter number 1, and verses 11 to 24, Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 to 24, I want you to know, brothers, that the gospel I preach is not something that man made up. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. Verse 12, something very significant there. Galatians 1:12. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. For you have heard my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many Jews of my own age and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from birth, called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him to the Gentiles, I did not consult any man. Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was. But I went immediately into Arabia and later to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter and stayed with him 15 days. I saw none of the other apostles. Verse 19, only James, the Lord's brother. Let me just clarify that Jesus had brothers and sisters after he was born. Only he was virgin born. Other children were born after Jesus. Only James, the Lord's brother. I assure you before God that what I am writing to you is not a lie. In verse 22, I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard the report that the one who was formerly persecuting is now preaching the faith. See, the point is that he gets saved on the road to Damascus, and then for a long time he is staying in Arabia and Damascus for about 3 years. Did not go up to Jerusalem, did not go to meet the apostles, did not get acquainted with them. Definitely, as a man who had been trained under Gamaliel, who was one of a great teacher of the law, a Pharisee, and Paul himself, who was a Pharisee, who's a teacher of the law, who knew the Old Testament scriptures very well and now had the revelation of Jesus, is processing the Old Testament scriptures and beginning to understand Christ. And is understanding the Messiah, receiving revelations from God. And after 3 years gets acquainted. It may not be that he never even preached once. Because the scripture tells us in Acts chapter 9 record of the conversion of Paul that at once he began to preach the gospel. And sometimes there could be a long time span between certain passages. But quite possibly he was processing scriptures, he was reading, he was understanding, he was learning, he was receiving revelations from God, he was receiving insights about who the Messiah is and how the old covenant is culminating into the new covenant. And the wisdom of God in all of this. And that's why you see him writing so much, where Peter himself says in his writing that sometimes it's very difficult to understand Paul's writings and some choose to distort his writings. Paul bringing forth the manifold wisdom of God to the church. Revealing the manifold wisdom of God, was learning, was getting wiser, growing in understanding, growing in knowledge, growing in understanding what God is doing, who Jesus is, what is his word saying. What are the old scriptures, Old Testament scriptures pointing to? How is it bringing forth, pointing and revealing the Messiah? Getting wisdom from God. There are some silent years in people's lives where they were growing in wisdom. You look at that in the life of Daniel. You look at that in the life of Joseph in the Old Testament, where there was a long time before they came into a public life, before a long time before they came into operating in the gifts and seeing their purpose of life being fulfilled. Before they could see the fulfillment, there were silent years in people's lives where they were growing in wisdom. Joseph was growing all through his life. There comes a point in his life where God brings him out in public. And so, all that I'm urging us this morning is that we need to understand that we need wisdom. And God is the author of wisdom, and God is the giver of wisdom. And we need to pursue wisdom. There are silent years in people's lives where they were pursuing wisdom, where they were growing in wisdom, where they were growing in understanding, growing in the knowledge of the Word of God, growing in revelation of Scriptures. I pray that every one of us will begin to experience growth in this year. This year, 2017. Let this year be a year where we will grow in wisdom, grow in the knowledge of the Word of God, grow in our understanding, have an increased measure of spiritual insight, and not be baby Christians anymore. Not be at the same level we were at last year and the years that have gone by. Sometimes we can just stay in that same place. And very often it's just a matter of choice that we have to make, that we have to decide and say, I need growth. I need understanding. I need to know something more. I need to learn. I need the wisdom of God to handle my life, to handle my family, to know God, to know Him more, to see His purpose, to see His way, to see His work in our life, in our family, in our home. We need the wisdom of God. It comes by asking. It comes by pursuing. It comes by embracing. It comes by desiring. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We can be at the same place. And we can be at the same level all through our lives. But what will happen, the dangerous thing that will happen is that we will be doing the same wrong things that we have done. We will be speaking the same, unwise way that we always spoke. We will be deliberately going about the same way we've always been. And always expecting better results, and we never see them. Sometimes can become very envious and jealous of others who are growing because they've grown in wisdom, and so their life grows, their perspective grows, their minds have become broadened where they can grasp a greater amount of things, and so they are able to be involved and do things that are beyond where they were at earlier in their life. You understand what I'm talking about? Amen. Hallelujah. Wisdom and knowledge is very powerful. It's very powerful. A person who is wise can guard their home, can protect their home, can guard the family, can keep their lives from falling apart. Look at Proverbs 14 and verse 1. The wise woman builds her house, but with her own hands, the foolish one tears hers down. The wise woman builds her house, but with her own hands, the foolish one tears hers down. There is the power in wisdom to build up, or in the lack of wisdom to destroy one's own house. You can see growth and building up, or demolishing and destroying all because of either wisdom or a lack of wisdom. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I pray that nobody will say at some point in life that if only had I thought differently. If only had I spoken differently. If only I had some wisdom. That nobody will say that. But it's gone to a regrettable point after some irreversible things have been spoken and done. But if we will act with wisdom and the wisdom of God, and we will grow in wisdom, that will keep us from danger and disasters and destruction. Wisdom can build up a house. Foolishness can destroy one's house. Hallelujah. Nobody wants to see destruction. But we want to see our lives built up. We want to see our homes built up. We want to see our families built up. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. With humility comes wisdom, the Bible says. With humility comes wisdom. If we will speak to somebody with humility, that can turn the heart of wrath. That can keep us from much danger. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It takes wisdom to do that. God will give us wisdom. We need wisdom. Let me show us a few other verses as well. All our doing, all our actions, all our words, everything come out of who we are. And if we are wise, if we are growing in wisdom, we will see the way we act, the way we talk, the way we deal with things, the way we deal with people, the way we deal with circumstances of life will be very different. It's necessary for us to take time to focus on our learning and our understanding by fearing God, setting our lives in order. Come with me to Proverbs chapter 9 and verses 10 to 12. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. There cannot be any true wisdom and knowledge and understanding without the knowledge of God, without pursuing God. It is by fearing God, by having the fear of God, living by fearing God. We live in a time where we live in a society, we live in a culture, we live in times where people don't fear and care for nothing. There's no sense of fear. People live with a mentality where they care for nothing. I don't care. Is the principle that people live by. Am I right? I don't care. Even if I'm messed up, it's my mess. You don't mess with me. Who are you to tell me what I should do? That's postmodern culture. Even if I'm messed up, it's my mess. You don't mess with me. That's the culture of the world. You see, there will always be a contradiction between the culture of the world and the biblical teaching. Don't get carried away by the mindset and the culture of the world. You will see your friends operating that way. You will see your colleagues operating that way. I don't care attitude. But the scripture talking about living by the fear of God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. No fear of any authority is the order of the day. No fear for parents, no fear for bosses, no fear for anybody. I don't care. Why should I fear? Why should I care? It's the principle of the world, it's the system of the world, it's the culture of the world. But that is not the biblical teaching. The biblical teaching is the fear of the Lord, that we live by fearing God. We fear God in everything we do. We fear God in what we say. If we fear God in our attitude, the kind of attitude we display, we fear God. There's a difference between terror and fear. We don't live in terror of who God is. God is not a terrorist who terrorizes us. But this is a healthy, loving, reverential fear. Sometimes we can overemphasize and out of proportion blow up the love of God and the grace of God and lose a healthy, necessary fear of God. Please listen to me very carefully. We can overemphasize and out of proportion blow up the love and the grace of God, which is happening in the Christian world, which is a very dangerous thing that is happening. Always speak about the love and the compassion of God. God is loving, God is compassionate, God is loving, God is compassionate, God is gracious. But also, God is a God of principles, righteousness and justice and judgment as well. Just because He is loving and gracious and kind and compassionate does not mean that He will ignore sin. Does not mean that we don't have to fear Him. We need to keep these in a balance. Have a healthy fear of God, where we fear God. Because while we do wrong, we can incur His wrath. He can be and will be displeased with us. Hello? Are you hearing me? While we do wrong, He can and He will be displeased with us. That is true. It's a lie of the devil that says, whatever you do, don't worry. Just ask for forgiveness and He will just forgive you and He will, and everything is fine. Oh, it's just, you just have to ask for forgiveness. That's taking the grace of God for granted. Without having a healthy fear of God, taking the grace of God for granted and the forgiveness of God for granted is a dangerous thing. That will lead us into a license to sin. That will slowly tell our conscience, oh, it's okay, God is loving, God is gracious, God is very kind. So it's okay. Don't worry, just ask for forgiveness. Yes. He'll forgive. Yes, He will forgive, no doubt. Even if a righteous man falls 7 times, he will still rise up. It is true. But that does not diminish the righteousness of God. That while we do something which displeases God, that He will be displeased. That we can grieve the Holy Spirit. That truth and reality will not be absent. Are you with me this morning? Hallelujah. And so it's important that we really have a genuine and the right fear of God. You see, very often for a lot of people, because they've had a wrong concept of God, a wrong understanding, a misplaced understanding of God, they've believed the wrong thing about God and have ended their lives with such misery, because they assumed God was somebody different, and they assumed that they will always have the kind of results that they want with the kind of life and the lifestyle that they lead. But very often later on they discover that they were wrong. That God is somebody who is different from what they thought God should be or to be. May we never misrepresent God in any way. And so when I explain about who God is, I have to be very careful that I don't give a very colored different picture about who God is. And if I give you a colored picture of who God is and train our minds to think that way, you know what can happen? The most dangerous thing is that you will believe that God is loving, God is gracious, God is kind, God is merciful. You just automatically just forgive. Don't have to be troubled about all of that. It's okay. Pat your own back all the time and justify all your actions. You know what will happen on the long run? It'll have very severe consequences. And so while we understand that we need to grow in the wisdom of God will come by living according to the fear of God, living by fearing God. It's not about being terrorized about God, but it's having a healthy, loving respect and reverence, where He will be displeased while we do wrong, but He will be pleased while we do right. Amen. has a fear of God. And so Solomon goes on to say in verse 11, for through me your days will be many and years will be added to your life. Through wisdom. It's about wisdom. Talking about wisdom. Proverbs 9:11. For through me your days will be many. Through wisdom your days. Brother, sister, if you are wise, if you gain wisdom, your days will be many and years will be added to your life. Verse 12, if you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. If you are a mocker, you alone will suffer. If you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. Wisdom brings a reward. Hallelujah. But where does wisdom come from? By the fear of God. Fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And as we go along, and going back to our culture, going back to our times, where we have lost respect to authority, we have lost respect to elders, we have lost respect to everything that has to be respected and honored. And we're moving into a culture of a lack of honor, lack of respect of anything and everything. And that also drives us to a lack of respect and reverence and fear of God. Amen? And so, may we come back to the biblical teaching of the Word of God to fear God. And by the fear of God, we will gain wisdom. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Are you able to see the contradiction that is there in our culture and the teaching of the Word of God? Are you able to see that? Are we able to see that? And so it's good for us to realize, are we following the culture of the world or are we following the teaching of Scripture? It's good for us to examine ourselves. Come back to Proverbs chapter 2. Proverbs chapter 2 and verses 1 through 8. It is very poetical, like as if wisdom is speaking. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, and if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Verse 7 is beautiful. He holds victory in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones. God protects us. God guards the course of our life. God protects the way of the faithful ones. He is a shield to those who walk blamelessly. He holds victory in store for the upright. While we pursue wisdom, while we embrace wisdom, while we grow in wisdom that comes from the fear of the Lord, and from his mouth will come knowledge and understanding. While we pursue what comes forth out of his mouth, what comes from his word, while we pursue the wisdom of God, we will see victory in our lives. Hallelujah. You will be victorious, brother. Sister, you will be victorious. Because as you pursue the wisdom of God by the fear of God, while you live fearing God and you grow in wisdom, victory is reserved for the upright. We will be living upright, blameless lives, and victory will be your reward. The Lord rewards the wise, we read. Victory will be our reward. Hallelujah. It might be in your workplace. It's very difficult for you to survive. Maybe it's very difficult for you to handle people around you. Your bosses, your subordinates, your colleagues. Maybe you need wisdom from God. Maybe in school, in college, dealing with friends. Maybe they make fun of you. Maybe they look down upon you. Maybe you are seeking for their acceptance. You need the wisdom of God. And maybe for the sake of earning their acceptance, maybe for the sake of, because of the pressure that you're going through from your friends, maybe you want to give in to what they expect. Maybe you want to act like how they act. Maybe you want to do the things that they do. Maybe you're driven to go around with them and fulfill their expectations just to earn their acceptance. But I want to tell you this morning, ask for the wisdom of God. May God give you the wisdom of how you need to handle your friends, when you need to say no, for what you need to say yes, to how much you can associate with them, and where you need to understand what's the principle of the Word of God. May God give you the wisdom and the discernment to handle your circumstances rightly. How to maintain a friendship but yet not comply into sinful deeds and lifestyles. The wisdom of God. May God give everyone the wisdom. Maybe when you come under tremendous pressure from neighbors, relatives, to make you to do the things that are contradicted to scriptures, may God give you the wisdom to take the right decisions, to take the right stand. We will grow in wisdom, that we will be wise in how we handle our circumstances of life. Everyone who was really wise were exalted. Hallelujah. Daniel was 10 times wiser than his friends. Exalted. Exalted in the kingdom of Babylon. Joseph gives a wise counsel to the king after interpreting the dreams. He does not just interpret the dream alone, but also gives him the counsel as to how the king needs to handle the situation, when the first 7 years of prosperity will come and then the 7 years of famine will come, what they need to do, how they need to handle this. And the king, Pharaoh, turns around and says, is there anybody in whom is the Spirit of the Lord like in Joseph? The Spirit of God will give you wisdom. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. To take the right decision, to do the right move, to speak the right thing, to meet the right person, to handle things rightly, to take the course of your life in the right manner, to order your life in a certain way. God will give you wisdom. The Spirit of God will give you wisdom. He will give you counsel even to the wise, to even counsel the wise. Hallelujah. He's made us wise, and He confounds the foolish, because we have received Jesus into our lives. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And quickly and lastly, Jesus grew in wisdom through submission. That's what we read in Luke 2:51. Submission will reward you with wisdom. In the silent years of his life, you see him growing in wisdom. Sometimes we need to go after those silent years. Not that we need to become silent, but what I'm talking about, that kind of a time period where we pursue wisdom, knowledge, understanding. Read the scriptures. Grasp things. Ask God for insight, revelation. Ask God for, you know, in every decision that you take, ask God for guidance. Ask the Holy Spirit to put words in your mouth. Go by the principles of the Word of God. Look for what the scripture is saying concerning any matter about your life. Go read through the scriptures. Search in the scriptures and see, is there something the Word of God is saying about this kind of a situation that I can learn from? Luke 2:51. Wisdom comes from submission. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. Yes, he was already deliberating, and he was in conversations, and he was speaking to the teachers of the law. He was asking them questions. He was answering. He didn't lack wisdom when he was 12 years old, but yet he went to submit to his parents. In submission, there's wisdom. And there it says, Jesus grew in wisdom and stature, in favor with God and man. He was disciplined by his parents. They come and question him. Son, where have you been? Why did you do this to us? Why didn't you tell us? Why did you stay back in the temple? They disciplined him. Do you think Mary was wrong when she asked that question to Jesus? As a good mother, she asked the right questions. Why didn't you come home? Why didn't you inform us? Discipline, Jesus. For some of us, it might be very difficult to process these things. Jesus being disciplined? Jesus is God. Yes, he was truly human as well. He submitted himself to his parents. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. Some kids and young people might be wishing that they just didn't have to listen to this message. Paul the Apostle, writing to the Ephesian church, talks about honoring father and mother. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And if you honor your father and mother, then all will go well with you and you will enjoy long life on the earth. And so in submission, it's not just only talking about children here. It's not just talking about young people here. It's talking about for every one of us. In submission we learn. In being disciplined, in being willing to go through the process of disciplining by God, we learn wisdom. We receive wisdom. Come with me to Proverbs chapter 3 again. Verses 11 to 18. Proverbs 3, 11 to 18. My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline. Do not resent his rebuke. Because the Lord disciplines those he loves. As a father, the son he delights in. Some fathers say, I don't discipline my child at all. I will not say anything. Supposedly, certifying upon themselves a superior righteousness to those fathers who discipline their children. Supposedly certifying on themselves a superior level of righteousness over the others who discipline their children. The Bible clearly says, he who spares the rod hates the son. He who spares the rod hates the son. It is not right for parents not to discipline children. It is not right. It is necessary and it is biblical. And it is right for parents to discipline their children. Because the Lord disciplines us as his children. Amen. Praise the Lord. Why does he discipline us? Because he loves us. If you truly love your children, you will discipline them. You will not want them to go the wrong way. And so don't assume that if you don't say anything, then that's greater righteousness. No, that's actually wrong. Thereby you will actually allow your children to go into the wrong way. Now come back to chapter 3 and verse 11 and 12. My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline. Do not resent his rebuke. Because the Lord disciplines those he loves. As a father, the son he delights in. Blessed is the man who finds wisdom, the man who gains understanding, for she is more profitable than silver and yields better returns than gold. She's more precious than rubies. Nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, in her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are pleasant ways and all her paths are peace. She's a tree of life to those who embrace her. Those who lay hold of her will be blessed. It comes through a disciplined life and going through the process of disciplining, being disciplined. God disciplines us. God allows chastisement, and they are for our good. Sometimes it's in the form of sickness. Sometimes it is in the form of financial problems. Sometimes it is in the form of relationship issues. Sometimes it is in the form of uncontrollable circumstances that go beyond our control. Sometimes it is the form of delayed answers to prayers. It is in different ways. God disciplines us in different ways. God chastises us in different ways. And it is good for us. It is good for you. It's good for me. Amen. Because that draws us closer to God. Our problems, our weakness, our sufferings, our trials draw us close to God. If we hate God's discipline, if we hate God's chastisement, what will happen is that we will keep going away from God. We will live in our own wicked ways. And that will lead us to the path of destruction. But it is good that God disciplines us. And by His disciplining, we earn wisdom. We learn to be wiser. We learn to be careful. We learn to be alert. We learn to be very, very, thoughtful about what we are doing and what we are saying. Are you with me this morning? Amen? Because the Lord disciplines those He loves as a father, the son He delights in. Blessed is the man who finds wisdom. Look at that. It's beautiful. Verse 16 to 18. Long life is in her right hand. For those who have wisdom. Long life is in her right hand. In her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are pleasant ways, and all her paths are peace. She's a tree of life to those who embrace her. Those who lay hold of her will be blessed. That comes by being disciplined. And as a parent, I want to encourage every parent here, speak to every father, every mother here, that don't be without disciplining your children. Whatever age they might be. Of course, the kind of relationship changes quite a bit from being a 3-year-old and then when the child is 30-year-old. The way you deal and everything definitely changes quite a bit. But yet, let me caution us, and according to the Word of God, that we don't stop disciplining. Here, God's discipline is compared to a father disciplining a son. Look at this. I'm not saying, but the scriptures are saying that. Verse 12, because the Lord disciplines those He loves as a father the son He delights in. As a father disciplines the son He delights in. If you really love your child, discipline them. Tell them when it's wrong, tell them it's wrong. When they're going the wrong path, tell them it's wrong when they're going the wrong path. Don't encourage them to do wrong. Don't cover and shield when they do wrong. When something is not right, when something is not good for them, when something is not biblically right, when they're speaking a lie, when they're covering up something, don't join along with them and cover it. Don't cover up, but confront it. Amen. It's good to confront things within the four walls of the house than for the world outside and the things after they have done to come and confront them. Listen to me carefully. It's good to be confronting them within the four walls of the house than for them to be confronted by the things they have done. You know that woman who was caught in the act of adultery was brought to Jesus and she was confronted by the thing that she had done. It's better you confront your child within the four walls of the house than for the thing that they have done to come and confront them. Amen. Hallelujah. As a father disciplines a son, so the Lord disciplines us. There is wisdom in it. It is not a bad thing. There is wisdom in it. It will make them wise. And you will also do the wise thing for your child. Hallelujah. Don't encourage them and cover up when they do wrong. And the moment they know that you are covering up when they have done wrong, they will choose to do more wrong more boldly. Because they know, my mother will cover it up and hide it from my father. That's the most dangerous thing that can happen between parents. That's the greatest disservice a parent will do towards a child. Where one of them will shield and one of them against the other. Amen? It's not a very exciting thing to say a louder amen. But these are things that we might have to really think through. When we are saying that we want to grow in wisdom, and when we might get excited, we can shake our hands and pray, Lord, give me wisdom.
But well, we need to act upon wisely with the teaching that is already given there, which are wisdom to us, which is wisdom to us already. Hallelujah. Don't expect for some kind of a dumping of some bin full of wisdom into your head from heaven above while you fast and pray and shake your hands without getting wisdom from the scriptures. Some people have misunderstood these things. They think that, oh, Bible, okay, I read the Bible and all that. But, you know, God will give me wisdom directly. No, He will not bypass this and give us some wisdom. He will not tear open some bin full of wisdom and dump into our heads without letting us go through the scriptures. Here is the word of wisdom to us. Here are the teachings of wisdom to live wisely given to us, handed down to us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's pursue this, the word of God, the wisdom of God, and live by the fear of God and allow God to discipline us, and we will become wiser. Amen. That will help us to live a disciplined, godly life, and we will grow in wisdom and in stature. Favor with God, favor with man. Praise the Lord.